एक्टिंग हो रही है वार्ड में, एग्जामिनेशन के टाइम पे वो पहले से एडमिटेड है और उसका जो है प्रोलैप्स रिड्यूस हुआ है। वो पेशेंट हिस्ट्री देती है कि बाहर आता है लेकिन पैकिंग की वजह से अब वो बाहर नहीं आ रहा, तो उस
बिल्कुल,
केस में हम इसका स्पेकुलम करेंगे।
ये अगर बाहर नहीं आ रहा तो आपने सर्विक्स को तो देखना है,
जी
एग्जाम
सर,
लेना है, इसलिए आप स्पेकुलम करेंगी, सर्विस को डिस्क्राइब करेंगी और फिर वो पैप स्मियर भी लेंगी। हाँ अलबत्ता अगर यूट्रोवेजाइनल प्रोलैप्स का पेशेंट है, आपका कस्कोस नहीं इस्तेमाल करेंगी, आप सिम स्पेकुलम इस्तेमाल करेंगी। सिम स्पेकुलम इस्तेमाल होता है या लेफ्ट लेटरल या सिम्स पोजीशन या लिथोटमी पोजीशन, इन तीन में से कोई एक पोजीशन में मरीज को डाल के आप सिम्स करेंगी, आप डॉर्सल पोजीशन में नहीं करेंगी जिसमें कि नॉर्मली हम कस्कोस डाल के कर लेते।
थैंक यू सो मच सर, थैंक यू सो मच।
मेरा ख्याल 5 मिनट ऊपर हो गए तो काफी हैं आप लोग ज्वाइंट मोर देन 30, तो हम शुरू करते हैं। लेकिन डॉक्टर हसनिया प्लीज प्रेजेंट योर केस।
13 years old, कौसर परवीन, डॉटर ऑफ खालिद, स्टूडेंट, अनमेरिड, रेजिडेंट ऑफ कोरंगी, एडमिटेड थ्रू आउट पेशेंट डिपार्टमेंट फ्रॉम JPMC ऑन 18 फेब 2021 विद द चीफ कंप्लेन ऑफ फेलियर टू इनिशिएट मेंस्ट्रुएशन टिल द एज ऑफ 13 years एंड साइक्लिक लोअर एब्डोमिनल पेन सिंस 3 months। अकॉर्डिंग टू द मदर ऑफ माई पेशेंट, शी डेवलप अ सेकेंडरी सेक्शुअल करेक्टर ऑफ द फॉर प्यूबिक एंड ब्रेस्ट एट द एज ऑफ 9 and 10 years, बट एक्सिलरी हेयर्स नॉट डेवलप। हर एज ऑफ मीनार्की ऑफ मदर एंड शी इज थर्ड नंबर इन हर सिस्टर। हर एज ऑफ मीनार्की ऑफ मदर एंड हर सिस्टर एट द एज ऑफ 11 and 12 years अलॉन्ग विद डेवलपमेंट ऑफ सेकेंडरी सेक्शुअल कैरेक्टर्स, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ डिलेड मीनार्की। मदर गिविंग नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ डिले माइल स्टोन अचीव, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ वेट गेन, एक्सेसिव हेयर ग्रोथ, नो हिस्ट्री ऑफ ब्रेस्ट डिस्चार्ज, नो सिग्निफिकेंट ड्रग हिस्ट्री लाइक एंटी डिप्रेसन एंजियोलाइटिक, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ हेड एक, वॉमिटिंग एंड सिंकपी अटैक, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ कोल्ड एंड हीट इंटॉलरेंस, सोमनलेंस, लिथार्जी, एंड देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ सिवियर स्ट्रेस एंड विग्रेस एक्सरसाइज। पेशेंट डिफ्रेंशिएट बिटवीन डिफरेंट टाइप ऑफ द स्मेल, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ हेड सर्जरी, ट्रामा, रेडिएशन, देर इज नो एनी देर इज नो एनी सेम प्रॉब्लम इन हर फैमिली। मदर हैविंग नो एनी प्लान ऑफ अ मैरिज इन नेक्स्ट 7 into 10 years ऑफ माई पेशेंट। पेशेंट है मदर ऑल्सो गिव अ हिस्ट्री ऑफ साइक्लिक लोअर एबडोमिनल पेन अलॉन्ग विद रिटेंशन ऑफ द यूरिन, सो शी वेंट टू द SIUT हॉस्पिटल कराची थ्रू इमरजेंसी डिपार्टमेंट वेयर हर आर वर्कअप, ब्लड एंड यूरिन टेस्ट डन। एट द टाइम ऑफ द इमरजेंसी हर अल्ट्रासाउंड डन इन इमरजेंसी बेसिस विच शो कलेक्शन ऑफ द फ्लूड इन द पेरिनियल एरिया, सो पेशेंट रिफर इन टू द गायनी ओपीडी फॉर फर्दर मैनेजमेंट ऑफ द पेशेंट। इन ड्यूरिंग हर एडमिशन इन द हॉस्पिटल हर आल ब्लड टेस्ट एंड यूरिन टेस्ट डन एंड पेशेंट टेकिंग अ डेट ऑफ द MRI एंड द पेशेंट कंसल्ट अबाउट द एनेस्थीजिया फिटनेस एंड एग्जामिनेशन अंडर एनेस्थीजिया एंड आफ्टर एनेस्थेटिक फिटनेस एंड नो एनी मेडिकेशन गिवन टू माई पेशेंट इन ड्यूरिंग एडमिशन। रिगार्डिंग हर देर इज नो एनी सिग्निफिकेंट पास मेडिकल एंड द सर्जिकल हिस्ट्री। रिगार्डिंग हर फैमिली हिस्ट्री, देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ हाइपरटेंशन, डायबिटीज, एस्थमा इन हर फैमिलीज, एंड देर इज नो एनी हिस्ट्री ऑफ ओवेरियन, यूट्राइन, कोलोरेक्टल एंड ब्रेस्ट कार्सिनोमा। एंड रिगार्डिंग हर पर्सनल हिस्ट्री, स्लिप एंड एपिटाइट नॉर्मल अकॉर्डिंग टू माई पेशेंट, बाउल हैबिट्स आर नॉर्मल, एंड हर फादर इज अर्न 10 to 12,000 पर मंथ, एंड शी हैज़ थ्री सिस्टर एंड द टू ब्रदर, एंड ऑल फैसिलिटीज ऑफ द लाइफ मेट विद द डिफिकल्टी। सर एग्जामिनेशन बता दूँ?
जी बोलते बोलते कंप्लीट कर लीजिए। यस गो ऑन।
यंग गर्ल सिटिंग ऑन द बेड कंफर्टेबली, वेल ओरिएंटेड टू टाइम प्लेस एंड पर्सन बीएमआई ऑफ माय पेशेंट इज 18.5 रिगार्डिंग हर जनरल फिजिकल एग्जामिनेशन पेशेंट वाइटली स्टेबल सर इस पेशेंट ने जो है ना हमें एग्जामिनेशन वार्ड में करनी तो नहीं थी बट माय कुलीग टेक द एग्जामिनेशन इन ओपीडी सो सर मैं वही फाइंडिंग आपको बताना चाहूंगी जो ओपीडी में उस वक्त देखी गई एनीमिया जॉइंटस क्लबिंग साइनोसिस किलोनाइकिया एडिमा एंड एसेसरी लिम्फ नोड्स आर नॉट पल्पेबल थायराइड नॉट एनलार्ज ड्यूरिंग हर एग्जामिनेशन हर ब्रेस्ट डेवलप एट द टेनर स्टेज 4 विद द स्पार प्यूबिक हेयर on per abdominal examination per abdominal examination abdomen soft and slightly tender at the lower side her mass of about cystic mass of about 14 weeks which felt felt and soft in consistency on per vitreal examination not done but on inspection there is a bulging bluish membrane seen on inguinal examination there is no any lymph node and any growth seen at the line at the inguinal region and the labia majora and there is no any web neck no white carrying angle and no shield chest
good have you finished
yes sir
can you make a brief summary of your patient's history
13 years old 13 years old unmarried girl not attained the age of menarche till the age of 13 years with the abnormal with the secondary sexual character not fully developed and breast at the tender stage 4 and with the spar pubic hair and with the ultrasound finding of the hematocolpus and the hematocolpus
good I think is reasonably good. You have taken barely 4 minutes in presenting your history. This is very good. I always time this and make this announcement how many minutes you have taken, because you know in examination you feel that long history it will take me much more time, so you cut short your history, omit parts of the history or physical examination. It is definitely not on. You go narrate your history as you have taken, as much detail as you have, not unnecessary detail, but as much as relevant detail, and you will not consume too much time. So one, you have done it well in 4 minutes. But the important part of your history is knowing the patient's diagnosis, that shall we call it primary amenorrhea, and you have read the causes of primary amenorrhea, and in your history, right from head down, you have named negative things about the absence of any brain injury, hemorrhage, pituitary related, and all those things you have mentioned. It's very good. But before you went on to complete your history, you sort of derailed yourself. You started telling me about the family history in her present history, so which you subsequently also repeated again. The thing is that you should have completed your patient's history and then, after completion of that, gone on to the family history, like two other sisters and things like that. So, but generally, it is good. And today, we'll talk about this subject. One, particularly this patient, which you have almost completed, and how she should be treated and all that. And secondly, we'll discuss a patient of primary amenorrhea. If she presents to you in examination, how will you go about such a patient? Because this patient, he is age 13, menarche hasn't started, but she is, for last 3 months, she is having lower abdominal pain. You did not dilate on that, that pain comes after every month for 3-4 days or something like that. Yes. Secondly, you did not tell me the character of the pain. You told me lower abdominal pain. The pain is present during menstruation. It is continuous or colicky, and it gradually gets worse over 3 days, and then suddenly stops, because that would be the character of this pain. Because the pain is because of stretching of the upper part of vagina and maybe uterus. And that during menstrual flow, it is minimal on first day, maximal on last day. But when the bleeding stops, the pain stops. So the character of the pain, you did not dilate, you did not, doesn't matter. So with this, you see, the second thing, you said her secondary sex characters are not well developed. Whereas you're telling me her breasts are Tanner 4. Maximum development of the breast is Tanner 5. And so I would say her breasts are reasonably well developed. And secondly, the only deficient factor perhaps which you mentioned, her pubic hair are sparse. They are not many. But that is not the only secondary sex character which is important. That, you know, at the age of puberty, first breast buds, they start developing, then axillary and pubic hair appear, and menstruation or menarche is the last thing which happens, which hasn't happened in this case visibly, although she is a case of cryptomenorrhea. Cryptomenorrhea means hidden menstruation. So there's a little criticism about your physical finding, but on examination, you did mention her BMI is 18, and I would imagine that she is, for her age, perhaps underweight and things like that. But generally good. So first of all, in this patient, because she is a case where menarche hasn't set in, or primary amenorrhea, but the cause is so visible from history and physical examination and ultrasound. I don't know why she was going to have MRI. What's the advantage of MRI in this patient? I would say that is superfluous in investigation in this patient, because best diagnosis is made on local examination, which you described, that her hymen is bulging, bluish membrane, and then there's a mass about 12 to 14 weeks size in lower abdomen, which perhaps is slightly tender. And ultrasound is the best tool in this case to make a diagnosis that she is a case of cryptomenorrhea.
Can I tell you the ultrasound finding?
Please. Okay.
Uterus is 6.6, 3.2, and 4.2 centimeter. Endometrial thickness 6 mm. Right ovary measuring 2.9 into 1.9 centimeter. Left ovary 2.8 and 1.9 centimeter. Slight fluid in the cul-de-sac. Endometrial thickness in the upper segment already mentioned that 6 mm. Lower endometrial cavity show a thick fluid with internal echoes volume 25 mm, suggestive of hematometropause. And bracket measure diagnosis may be in perforated hymen. And another ultrasound which show endometrial thickness 1.5 centimeter and collection of fluid about 10.2 into 6.5 centimeter with the hematopolpos.
So both she had ultrasound done abdominally twice, and both reports are showing some accumulation of fluid in the upper part of vagina, even in the uterus hematometer. So after this, there's no need for MRI. So in examination, if you say MRI, it will not get you good marks. It will, as a matter of, dilute your performance, because unnecessary investigation should not be done. Unnecessary investigation. So here, abdominal ultrasound is good enough. We don't need her karyotype. We don't need her FSHLH. We don't need such investigations. So if you do that, it will not be a good thing. Here, it is a typical case of obstruction in the genital tract, possibly low down. And when this was, you told me that she was taken to operation theater for EUA. only EUAY when the obstruction of bluish membrane was visible in the mother and the girl, little girl, but mother particularly, should have been counseled about the diagnosis and definitive treatment. That is cruciform incision of the hymen. That is simple. You didn't mention whether that was done or not. You told me only EUA was done. That is also incomplete treatment when the diagnosis was made by ultrasound and physical examination. So the proper treatment would have been counseling of the mother before taking the patient to theater, then EUA and definitive treatment, cruciform incision and of the hymen. No EUA after incision of the hymen, because introducing finger into the vagina, no matter how aseptic measures are, would risk the infection. So only incision and drainage of the hematocorpus. So that would. So it's good, Dr. Hastinia. So we covered that. The first, it was a case of obstruction in the lower genital tract leading to cryptomenorrhea, and the treatment is counseling, EUA, and incision, say cruciform incision, incision of the hymen, or if it was higher up, vaginal septum, whatever it is, we make cruciform incision, and that is it, and let it drain, and patient is cured. Subsequently, she would have regular menses as it was. So that was it. But I thought in examination, you may not get such a typical patient. Generally speaking, let's forget about history of pain lower abdomen. Generally speaking, a mother will bring a daughter of 12 to 14 years of age that her menses have not started. Her menarche has not started. And we will label that as a case of primary amenorrhea. So if a patient is brought to you, young girl, mother complaining at this age, 12 to 14 years of age, that her sister started menses earlier, but she hasn't started, then how shall we proceed? Number one, you will take detailed history as Dr. Hastinia has demonstrated, keeping in view all the causes of primary amenorrhea. She started, mentioned any history related to brain, history related to hypothalamus, history related to pituitary, then general health, general nutrition, and history of drugs, history of chronic illness, and nutrition, and her dietary habits, whether she was taking normal diet or excessive. See, this is a huge list of causes of amenorrhea, which after reading the chapter, Dr. Hastinia took the history, and in the history presented that all these possible causes of primary amenorrhea. So you'll take the same detailed history as Dr. Hastinia did. But then how shall we proceed further after taking the history? I would say the most important thing is you notice the development of secondary sex characters of that patient. As it happened in this case, that she had almost normal development of secondary sex characters. Breasts were fully developed, 10 or 4, and axillary hair were present, and pubic hair, maybe sparse, but they were present, and vulva was well developed, as you described, that membrane was bulging out and pollution. So So first thing which you will note, look for is in a case of primary amenorrhea, whether the secondary sex characters are developed or not developed. Now, if the secondary sex characters are developed, first we notice that they are developed, then what should be our thought process? What could be the possible causes with normal secondary sex characters? As Dr. Hasnia mentioned, first of all, we start from the top, from the brain. She mentioned she could smell, the patient can smell normally. That means she was thinking of Kallmann syndrome. And then she mentioned she doesn't suffer from any depression or any psychotic illness. That means her brain as such. And then she mentioned about thyroid function. She doesn't feel hot or cold, or she's not lethargic. She did mention that there's no chronic disease like tuberculosis, like sarcoidosis, or any other chronic illness. And then she's not taking any drugs. Dr. Saskian did mention there's no history of chemotherapy or any other medication. There are so many drugs which interfere with gonadotropins, like psychotic drugs, like hypotensive therapy, and addictive drugs, cocaine, opiates. They are all, they interfere with our endocrinological systems. So starting from the brain, then we come to pituitary. You will declare here, Dr. Askington, there is no galactorrhea. And that there is no thyroid enlargement on physical examination. You did mention BMI, which is very important, her height and weight. Because excessive weight or anorexia nervosa, too little weight, both can cause primary amenorrhea. Height is important because internal syndrome, the height is short. In androgen insensitivity, the height is tall. So height and weight are important. And then you didn't mention, because it was not necessary here, any signs of hirsutism. Excessive growth of hair. Because even at this age, there could be PCO. Very early age, but still there could be PCO. So these things should be mentioned on physical examination, which perhaps lead you to some diagnosis, as the list of differential diagnoses you mentioned. If the secondary sex characters are well developed, as in this case, then the other possibility is you may find a patient where secondary sex characters are not well developed. That patient is different patient now. Because in that patient, there's 60% chance that there's developmental anomaly and 40% chance there's endocrinological disorder. So, keeping this in view, developmental anomaly, we'll look for any other, as you mentioned, Turner syndrome, web neck, wide angle, you mentioned. And so any other developmental anomaly which is visible in that particular patient? Her height, as I mentioned earlier. And then we come to investigations. After we split our findings with those related to well-developed secondary sex characters, normal secondary sex characters, and those related to the secondary sex characters not so well. So when secondary sex characters not well developed, we'll think of these two possibilities, developmental anomalies and endocrinological disorders. Keeping this in view, we come to investigation then. Basic investigations are ultrasound, abdominally. That's the most useful investigation because it will show you presence of uterus, ovaries, or absence of uterus and ovaries, or presence of any other gonads. As in this present case, obstruction in the genital tract. So ultrasound is the most useful investigation. If ultrasound shows normal uterus or for that age and gonads, then because menses have not started, menarche has not started, so we'll do investigation like hormones, FSH, LH, prolactin, presence of estradiol, and if hirsutism there, then level of androgens or testosterone. I said if that is. And if you suspect developmental anomalies, then we'll do karyotyping as well. After this is small list. Investigations are routine in after routine investigations for her health, ultrasound, hormone estimations. Rarely, EUA will be required, but not generally. And CT and MRI. Minimal, rarely, maybe to locate gonads in the abdomen or high up or size of the ovaries, maybe, but very uncommon. When you have done these investigations, now let's discuss them one by one. If ultrasound shows uterus is absent, then we'll do karyotyping. Karyotyping will show whether her chromosome 46XX or any abnormality, chromosomal anomaly. If it is 46XX, then possible her gonads are normal. May not be functioning normally, but they are there. If it is 46XY, possibly she is a case of androgen insensitivity. She is XY, but her phenotype is like a woman because the tissues do not respond insensitive to testosterone. न्यूट्रल सेक्स इज फीमेल, सो न्यूट्रल सेक्स डेवलप्स एंड इफ इट इज 46XY, but this could be possible syndrome. There are quite a few, as one mentioned by you, Kelman syndrome, Rokitansky-Meyer syndrome, all these, one of those, we'll talk about them later. So we'll do a karyotyping, which will show us whether she is 46XX, which means normal karyotype, or 46XY or any chromosomal anomaly like Turner syndrome, X0. So that will be a help. Once we have done that, if it is a normal XX, and we look for, and uterus is present, ovaries are present, do we look for cryptomenorrhea? Possibly she is a case of cryptomenorrhea. But if we don't find on ultrasound any fluid retention, then the second possibility is there is constitutional delay. As you mentioned, that in the family, there was no constitutional delay. So we'll go into the family history. There's no constitutional delay. So these are chromosome 46XX, normal chromosome. And then we'll do ultrasound for location of uterus and gonads. And if they are present, possibly constitutional delay or it is outflow obstruction. If 46XX normal and uterus is present, there is no obstruction, and we will rule out like thyroid diseases, prolactinoma, Cushing syndrome, androgen excessive, or PCO. We'll think of those things. That in, if there's no secondary sex characters, then the possible cause is in the ovaries are high up. Then presence of FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, will be a great help in finding out what could be the possible cause. If FSH is normal, karyotype is normal, then again, we think of constitutional delay. Or if FSH is low, then possibly she is a case of Turner syndrome, which will be diagnosed by karyotyping. Or cause in hypothalamus, we look for the cause in the brain or pituitary. And then in the book, various syndromes are described, like Kelman syndrome, Lawrence Moon-Peters syndrome, Prader-Willis syndrome, any of those syndromes, if FSH is low. If FSH is high, premature ovarian insufficiency. I repeat, we'll do hormone estimations, FSH particularly. If FSH is normal, then it's possibly constitutional delay. If FSH is low, one of those syndromes are caused in the brain, or hypothalamus or pituitary. If FSH is high, is premature ovarian insufficiency. Then we come to the management. So basically, I repeat, the investigations were, after healthcare investigations, hormone estimations, FSH, LH, prolactin, karyotyping, if necessary. But on top of the list is golden rule for investigation, ultrasound, which will tell you whether uterus is normally formed, not formed, gonads normally present, not present, or obstruction in the passages. These are investigations. Then we come to management. If you make a diagnosis, this is delayed menarche or constitutional delay, then the patient needs only reassurance. If you find it's obstruction in the passage, we talked about it earlier, that you take care of that obstruction surgically, make incision in the obstructing membrane, whether it is septum or it is hymen. If secondary sex characters are not developed, we wait till the age of 16. And then possibly start estrogen replacement therapy. And if uterus is present, FSH are low, maybe you can start with cyclical therapy to cause withdrawal bleeding. Normally, if the uterus is small in size, the presence of estrogen in OCP, oral contraceptive pill, is very small. So if at all, you prescribe that because it's cheap. Patient has to take it for months and years. So give double dose of that. If you make a diagnosis that is a premature ovarian insufficiency, then in addition to cyclical therapy, you have to think of her fertility. Either storage of her ova, which they are present maybe at this stage, later they will not be. But if the patient comes to you late, then donor egg surrogacy will be the treatment for POI, premature ovarian insufficiency. If she is a case of androgen insensitivity, that means she is XY, she needs gonads for production of estrogens. But remember, undescended testes, XY means she has got testes in her body. Undescended testes, they carry risk of cancer. So you will have to follow her up. If you remove those testes or gonads, then replacement therapy with estrogens will have to be given. If she has got some chromosomal anomaly, these days her fertility can be helped by donor eggs or even by surrogacy. And during early pregnancy, NIPT test can be done. Non-invasive prenatal testing. Brand name is Harmony Test. If the cause is in thyroid, hyper or hypo, you know the treatment. Or there's excessive androgen production, virilization and all that. For that, she may need estrogen from outside, and for her hirsutism, treatment by beautician, laser or any other treatment. If the cause of her amenorrhea is anorexia, depression, or any other psychotic illness, she'll need help of a psychiatrist. In anorexia nervosa, FSH production is low, so stimulation of the ovaries doesn't take place. But the ovaries are normal. They can be helped by IVF or ART technology. If she suffers from any chronic disease, tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, or any ill health, obviously, correction of her health may rehabilitate her menstruation or bring the treatment. We have still 15 minutes. I have intentionally covered it in half an hour so that we could discuss your questions if you have. Well, finally, before I close this, first I must compliment the presenter, Dr. Hasaniya. Dr. Hasaniya.
Dr. Hasina.
Hasina. That's what. My apologies. Tum to Hasina ho. So, acha. Well, you look like Hasina anyway. So, aapki presentation bahut achhi thi. That was very good. Well prepared. At least you had read the chapter about primary amenorrhea. That's something that if you read and then present, then your presentation shows that you have read it. You did that. That we covered that. That was a very small section of primary amenorrhea, obstructive primary amenorrhea or cryptomenorrhea, how it should be diagnosed and treated. That's very simple.
I have one question. In exam point of view, examiner told me the ultrasound finding later. Then we go for the hormonal treatment at that time or not? Like FSH, LH, estradiol?
Yeah, then you don't know whether
karyotype
is obstructive. Then you start from there. Okay, madam, if I don't have her ultrasound finding, then there are two possibilities. Then either she, because she has fully developed secondary sex characters, so possibility is she is a case of 46XX, and I'll do hormone studies first, because she, or if you, they are not fully developed, then I'll do hormone studies, including thyroid, including androgens, and also karyotyping.
Regarding her management, initially 2 years, we give a low dose estrogen. So we can tell in exam like that, or we give OCPs like it's a cheap and easily available?
When you say OCP, you add to it. The dose of estrogen in OCP is very low. Hence, it is not HRT, hormone replacement treatment. So because this is a long-term treatment, it goes for not months, years. And patients, if you prescribe expensive treatment, for years, she will not take it. This OCP is for 4 rupees per month, which she is likely to get from family planning clinic free. And she is likely to be obedient to you and listen to you and continue this treatment. So I'll increase the dose.
Sir, 2 tablets daily, I'm thinking, or just taking the white tablets up to the 2 years, continuous.
If she wishes to have withdrawal bleeding, then also brown. If she doesn't wish to have brown withdrawal bleeding, then continuously white tablets.
Thank you, sir. Now you nicely explain all the things, and we don't know all the topic.
नहीं, वो ये मैंने इस तरह से ये डिजाइन किया है कि इम्तिहान में जो पेशेंट आएगा उसको फिर आगे चलाना है आपने, वो किताब में उस तरह नहीं लिखा हुआ, मेरी अपनी किताब में उस तरह नहीं लिखा हुआ. तो आपको पहले राइट फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग यू नोटिस फ्रॉम फिजिकल एग्जामिनेशन, पहले हिस्ट्री, फिर फिजिकल सेकेंडरी सेक्स कैरेक्टर्स देयर, देन दिस इज द लाइन. Secondary sex characters are not well developed, then this is the line. These are the possibilities.
Sir, and this case may...
For each possibility, you know the treatment. That is written in the book, but not in this fashion. Yes?
Sir, this case may jo hai na absent axillary hairs se, to wo hum counsel karenge ki wo aa jayenge after 13 years. Yeah.
Haan, wo aap se pucha jayega, inka sequence of development kya hai secondary sex characters ka, ke pehle breast develop hoti hai, phir axillary hair aate hain, phir pubic hair aate hain, phir menarche hoti hai. To agar ye her breasts of 10 or 4 axillary hair there, to wo pubic hair bhi abhi to she is 12 13 or 14 to aa jayegi. Ji, anybody else wishes to ask question?
Hello.
जी जी बोलिए.
सर जब ये estrogen replacement therapy देते हैं, उन्होंने कहा 2 tablets देंगे, तो 4 tablets देते हैं ना daily?
जी आप, मतलब मैंने कहा minimal dose है ये. पहले तो मैंने ये भी कहा up to the age of 14 or 16 कोई इतनी जरूरी भी नहीं है. आपको replacement therapy या ये OCP या कोई और देने की जरूरत इसलिए है कि इट टेक्स केयर ऑफ हर बोन्स, ऑस्टियोपोरोसिस ना हो उसको, चूंकि दे आर ईस्ट्रोजन डेफिशिएंट दीज पेशेंट्स. एंड उसके लिए मैं कहूंगा 2 भी काफी है, लेकिन अगर तो आप 4 भी दे, उसमें डोज इतनी कम है कि वो भी ठीक है.
थैंक यू सर.
और
सर आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन, लेकिन वो प्राइमरी मेनोरिया का नहीं है, वो रेकरेंट प्रेगनेंसी लॉस का है. सर मुझे
जी बोलिए।
सर मुझे ये पूछना है कि इन केसेस ऑफ रेकरेंट प्रेगनेंसी लॉस वी थिंक ऑफ अबाउट दीज थ्रोम्बोफिलियास, एक तो अक्वायर्ड और एक इनहेरिटेंट. तो अक्वायर्ड में तो हम लोग एप्ला का बोल देते हैं, लेकिन वो जो फैक्टर 5 लेडन ये सारी चीजें एंटी थ्रोम्बिन, ये क्या एट अ टाइम वी हैव टू आस्क फ्रॉम द एग्जामिनर और वी जस्ट टेल इन मैनेजमेंट?
वो जी आप ये कहिए कि वो बड़ी सिंपल कि जी मुझे आप बता दीजिए अब तक इन्वेस्टिगेशन क्या हुई है। वो एग्जामिनर परहैप्स जनरली ये थ्रोम्बोफीलिया की या जो भी ये इन्वेस्टिगेशन था वो हुई नहीं होती, वो नहीं देगी। तो आप खुद ऐड कीजिए फिर कि जी इफ शी इज अ केस ऑफ रिपीटेड प्रेगनेंसी लॉस द पॉसिबिलिटी इज द सम डिफेक्ट इन द ब्लड। So I'll consult him. Multidisciplinary approach is a very convenient word. I'll seek multidisciplinary approach, a hematologist to seek detailed investigations about her thrombophilia. उसके नाम आप मुझे तो खुद नहीं पर I confess सार जितने डिफेक्ट हैं उनके नाम नहीं आते, लेकिन ये जरूर आता है कि हेमाटोलॉजिस्ट से मैं मशवरा कर लूंगा या कर लूंगी तो वो बता देगा कि क्या डिफेक्ट हो सकता है इस पेशेंट में। मुझे तो इतना सा पता है, आप चूंकि स्टूडेंट हैं, आप पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट जानते हैं, आपको आपका नॉलेज मुझसे ज़्यादा होना चाहिए डिटेल में, लेकिन प्रैक्टिकली सीक हेल्प ऑफ हेमाटोलॉजिस्ट।
ओके सर. सर ये भी मुझे पूछना था कि पॉलीहाइड्रोमिनोज में डू वी हैव टू टेल अबाउट द रोल ऑफ एंसर्स एंड पैरासेंटेसिस? अगर पेशेंट इज नॉन डायबिटिक एंड इज हैविंग ड्यू टू सम एनोमली पेशेंट इज हैविंग पॉलीहाइड्रोमिनोज, शी इज इन डिस्ट्रेस, तो उसमें एंसर्स और पैरासेंटेसिस के बारे में हम लोग बोलेंगे ना मैनेजमेंट टू रिलीव हर सिम्टम्स?
जी बिल्कुल बोल सके जी। ये पॉलीहाइड्रामिनोज जो है इज नॉट रिलेटेड टू हर हर हाइपरग्लाइसीमिया और डायबिटीज, तो अदर पॉसिबिलिटीज आर जो भी आप इंडस्ट करें वो जरूर बोलिए। तो लेकिन वो उनको वो इतना हाईलाइट ना कर लीजिए कि फिर उसमें फंस जाए, दलदल में फंस जाए आप। वो कहे जी ये पॉसिबिलिटीज है, लेकिन जो क्लिनिकल मैनेजमेंट जो आजकल आप कर रहे हैं अपने वार्ड में वो उसी पे फोकस रखिए उसको।
क्या क्रोनिक डायबिटीज है वो स्पिटिकल IUGR है?
IUGR जो नहीं है उसमें मैक्रोसोमिया होता है डायबिटीज में, लेकिन IUGR भी हो सकता है, हो सकता है, क्यों नहीं, किताब में लिखा हुआ है, मैंने कहा। जी
सर डिलीवरी ऑफ बेबी इन प्लेसेंटा प्रीविया, वेयर टू गिव इंसिशन, मतलब
वो
वो जो प्रॉपर
बात बड़ी सिंपल है कि प्लेसेंटा प्रीविया में वेदर यू विल गो थ्रू द प्लेसेंटा और अवे फ्रॉम द प्लेसेंटा, ये आपको उस वक्त ऑन द स्पॉट डिसाइड करना। इफ यू फील के प्लेसेंटा लार्ज बल्क आपके सामने पड़ा है उसके थ्रू कुछ जानने में प्लेसेंटा से ब्लीडिंग ज्यादा होगी, इतनी बेबी से ब्लीडिंग ज्यादा होगी, देन इट्स बेटर फॉर मदर एंड बेबी टू मूव मेक एन इंसिजन अवे फ्रॉम प्लेसेंटा व्हिच मींस इन द अपर सेगमेंट आइदर ट्रांसवर्स और वर्टिकल। तो लेकिन इफ यू फील दैट मार्जिन ऑफ
लेकिन
इज इन द लोअर सेगमेंट एंड यू कैन
बहुत सारे करेज करते हैं, लेकिन बुक्स में तो लिखा हुआ है, क्या
जी
कहते हैं यहाँ पे स्पॉट डिसाइड करना है आपने?
जरा बोलिए मैं भी सुनूं। नहीं आप चुप कर गई, कोई बात नहीं। तो यू कैन नॉट डिसाइड बिफोर हैंड अनलेस यू फील के प्लेसेंटा प्रीविया एंटीरियर है, वो सारा बल्क उसका सामने पड़ा है, तो फिर तो उसके प्लान करके ही जाएंगे हमने इंसिजन अबव द मार्जिन ऑफ द प्लेसेंटा बनाना है। लेकिन अगर प्लेसेंटा का मार्जिन जो है लोअर सेगमेंट में ही है जस्ट अबव दैट ट्रांसवर्स इंसिजन बनाई। थ्रू द
सर
भी जाना पॉसिबल है, प्रोवाइडेड इट इज क्लोज टू द मार्जिन, लेकिन मेन बल्ब के जरूर जाना जाने से फीटल ब्लड लॉस ज्यादा होगा और मटरनल ब्लड लॉस भी ज्यादा होगा। जी
अच्छा सर, एक ये सवाल था, जैसे कि अगर सस्पेक्टेड केस ऑफ विजाइनल सेप्टम हो तो उसके साथ जो है हमें आईवीपी भी करवाना पड़ता है ड्यू टू द एसोसिएशन ऑफ रीनल ट्रैक्ट एनोमलीज, तो शुड वी आस्क द एग्जामिनर फॉर दैट और नॉट?
जी बिल्कुल, जहां पे आप ये कहेंगे कि यूट्राइन एनोमली है लाइक रॉकी टंस्की सिंड्रोम में मुलेरियन डक्ट आपस में मिलती नहीं है, दे डोंट जॉइन, सो दे लीड टू यूट्राइन मैलफॉर्मेशन, जैसा आपने कहा राइट डाउन टू सेप्टम, वजाइना में भी हो सकता है, सेप्टम यूट्रस में भी हो सकता है, डबल यूट्रस भी हो सकते हैं, यूनिकॉर्नेट यूट्रस, ऑल दीज पॉसिबिलिटीज आर देयर। सो व्हेन एवर देयर इज डिफेक्ट ऑफ मलेरियन डक्ट्स देन द रिस्क ऑफ रीनल एनोमलीज इज हाई, तो इसलिए आप कहिए कि मैं किडनीज की भी इन्वेस्टिगेशन करवाऊंगी अल्ट्रासाउंड या IVU इफ नेसेसरी। चले 9 बज गए, यूसुफ साहब का टाइम हो गया है, थैंक यू वेरी मच, इट इज बिन प्लेजर टॉकिंग टू यू एंड प्लीज कम बैक नेक्स्ट टाइम, आस्क मोर क्वेश्चंस, मेरा इलम बड़ा खुद महदूद है लेकिन जहां तक होगा आंसर, थैंक्स अ लॉट, थैंक यू
सर, प्लीज एक क्वेश्चन का आंसर दे दें सर, क्या क्रोनिक डायबिटीज वाले पेशेंट में सिमेटिकल IgR होता है?
क्या IgR डायबिटीज
क्रोनिक डायबिटिक पेशेंट में सिमेट्रिकल IgR होता है?
मुझे सिमेट्रिकल IgR मींस के उसकी जो ज्यादा चांसेस ये हैं कि उसमें कोई एनोमली है, और चूंकि डायबिटिक बेबी में एनोमली भी हो सकती है और IgR भी हो सकता है, एनोमली भी हो सकती है, चूंकि पहले 6 to 8 weeks स्टेज पे एनोमली का रिस्क होता है, तभी जेस्टेशनल डायबिटीज में एनोमली नहीं होती चूंकि वो डेवलप होती है सेकंड या थर्ड ट्राइमेस्टर में, जो डायबिटीज Type 1, Type 2 है उसमें एनोमली हो सकती है, क्योंकि ब्लड शुगर का एबनॉर्मल लेवल अगर 6 to 8 weeks पे है उनमें रिस्क ऑफ एनोमली हाई है, तो अगर रिस्क एनोमली का भी है तो फिर वो सिमेट्रिकल IgR भी होता है।
थैंक यू सर,
थैंक यू, खुदा हाफिज,
थैंक यू सो मच सर।